I just thought they were trying times, but I did think things would get better, but I was fearful that they might get worse. There was always that chance that they might get worse, and they could have gotten worse.
If you come from the sullen element and the cross is burning in your yard every day, and then you get shot at every day, I've been shot at rifles. You ask your mother, your grandmother's been shot at with rifles. We all been shot at. I don't consider us no crusaders. I don't consider myself a crusader today. Never have considered myself a crusader. I didn't consider that I was having to be the person come along at the time. One thing that your great-great-grandmother taught us, which is my grandmother, is that politics makes the difference. That you ever gonna change anything in this country, you gotta do it politically.
Now the time has come for this nation to fulfill its promise. The events in Birmingham and elsewhere have so increased the cries for equality that no city or state or legislative body can prudently choose to ignore them. The fires of frustration and discord are burning in every city, north and south. Where legal remedies are not at hand, redress is sought in the streets, in demonstrations, parades, and protests, which create tensions and threaten violence and threaten lives. Next week, I shall ask the Congress of the United States to act, to make a commitment it has not fully made in this century to the proposition that race has no place in American life or law.
Okay, how did the branch start here in Lynn, the N.A.A.C.P. branch? I would like to tell you how that branch started. I'm rather proud of that fact. I was very hurt originally as to why there had to be a Lynn branch originally. But listen to this. The branch started years and years ago. The reason the branch started was there were two girls who were West Lynn girls. One graduated from classical high school. The other graduated from Cobbett and then entered classical high school. And in her junior year, her family moved to Boston, where she finished school at Boston Girls High. But she was born in Lynn and raised in Lynn all her life. Upon graduation, her ties were still here in Lynn. That's my sister. All right? They both decided to apply to the Lynn Hospital School of Nursing. They were best friends. All right? Two black girls. One named Smith, my sister, the other Green. They applied to the Lynn Hospital School of Nursing. Both honor students. All right? They were both denied the right to become nurses in this city. Why? Because they were refused, because they were of color, because they didn't think patients would want people of color touching them. Can you imagine this? Was this 100 years ago? No. This was in the 40s. This was not 100 years ago, this was in the 40s. This made newspaper headlines only because it was taken up by a local minister and some of our folks who got on board and just raised the devil, and it united us behind a cause. But you know what we lost? We won the war because Lynn Hospital decided they would accept blacks, or colored as we were called then. But you know what those two girls did? While this battle was going on, one applied to Boston City Hospital in Boston, and the other applied to a hospital school of nursing in New York. Both got accepted. Neither one has ever returned to Lynn. Both became nurses, One became a teacher of nurses, my sister, and the other went on to a full career as a nurse all their life. So that's how the Lynn branch was formed, from that one incident. Beginning, we never, and I'm telling the truth, we never expected it to be as magnificent or as world-shattering as it was. The momentum of that march just grew with the times in the country.
A march on what? I was involved in one of Martin Luther King's details, security detail. Our job was to take sure that nothing happened in the perimeters. You understand? So my position, I can show it to you, was in a tree. I was in the tree. I can show you where I was in the tree.
What were you looking for in that tree?
Anybody in the crowd might have been doing something, Marcus.
At this time, I have the honor to present to you the moral leader of our nation, Dr. Martin Luther King,
Jr. Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream, which was delivered on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial in Washington, D.C. in August of 1963. This is Nicole Smith.
I have a dream. I say to you today, my friends, so even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow,
I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream that one day, this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal.
I have a dream that one day on the Red Hills of Georgia, the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners we'll be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character.
I have a dream that one day every valley shall be exalted. Every hill and mountain shall be made low, the rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed in all. Shall see it together. This is our hope. This is the faith that I go back to the South with. With this faith, we will be able to hew out of the mountain of despair a stone of hope. With this faith, we will be able to transform the jangling discords of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood. With this faith,
we will be able to work together, to pray together, to struggle together, to go to jail together, to stand up for freedom together, knowing that we will be free one day. And this will be the day. This will be the day when we will be able to sing with new meaning, "My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing, land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride. From every mountainside, let freedom ring. And if America is to be a great nation, This must become true.
So let freedom ring from the prodigious hilltops of New Hampshire. Let freedom ring. from the mighty mountains of New York. Let freedom ring from the heightening Alleghenies of Pennsylvania. Let freedom ring from the snow-capped Rockies of Colorado. Let freedom ring from the curvaceous slopes of California. But not only that, let freedom ring from Stone Mountain of Georgia. Let freedom ring from Lookout Mountain of Tennessee. Let freedom ring from every hill and molehill of Mississippi, from every mountainside. Let freedom ring in Winding Cavern. When we allow freedom ring, when we let it ring from every village and every hamlet, from every state and every city, we will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
There is no state with a record that approaches that of Mississippi in inhumanity, murder, brutality, and racial hatred. It is absolutely at the bottom of the list.
Our cause too, because it's not just Negroes, but really it's all of us who must overcome the crippling legacy of bigotry and injustice, and we shall overcome.
He thought the NAACP back then would drag their feet.
Absolutely.
He could only get a little bit of time, because nobody, in my opinion, was willing to take on the establishment.
The NAACP has always tried to stay away from militancy, and the gay lords would come out with some militant statements.
Such as?
Oh, I can't think of any in particular, but they would come out with some militant things, and those were things that the NAACP, in their policy from National, would have to stay away from.
Meantime, we formed the organization as a civil club concerning strictly about horse playing, card playing, and everything else. When Reverend Reed, just before the march, and Samuel got involved, when Reverend Reed and all those people got killed, then we got serious. We got together with the NAACP, forget about what our difference might have been. We got together with them and everybody else, and we called in Eddie, because the young people in the city, in the West Lynn, had planned to burn the city of Lynn down.
Now, we've got some difficult days ahead, but it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop. I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place, but I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over and I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you,
But I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
On April 4, 1968, I had not been at work because one of my children had been ill. I had asthmatic children, and so I was at home. So I did hear the news right from the very beginning. I was distraught, but sad to say, not shocked at all, just totally overcome. I became one of those, I guess you call them a couch potato, because I then became glued to the TV. And I have to admit, I took the time I had coming to me from work, and I did not go to work again until Martin Luther King was buried.
Gentlemen, Mr. James Bolin.
Hi, kids. Thanks for inviting me. I got five kids myself. They're older than you. I took some movies here of a picket line. Well, first, before you see this movie, you're going to see a story of the Poor People's March. I took my kids with me to the Poor People's March. Now, this happened right after Martin Luther King was assassinated. And King was supposed to be the main speaker, the Poor People's March.
Describe what we're looking at. This is 1968. Once again, the same place where Martin Luther King gave his famous I Have a Dream speech. This is a few months after he was assassinated.
This is called Resurrection City, where the poor people built housing out of plywood, you know? They didn't dare drive them out, you know. They let them stay there and live in those plastic shacks. And as you can see, we walked all along, we watched all the different people, and we talked to the people that were living in these shacks. And they were there to demonstrate their hatred of racism and why they believed that all of us, you know, black and white, should live together in peace and harmony.
It was heartbreaking, heart-wrenching to think that people are so hurt and so caught up in their misery that they would go down there and do something like that, you know, and live like that. And to see our capital looking like that should have brought this country to its knees, and it didn't.
And I say segregation now, segregation tomorrow, and segregation forever.
I hope that we can have a cessation sometime of the demonstrations, although I recognize the right to peacefully assemble, but I do think there are limitations, but that's all.
Judge Wallace, that was not a happy time. to think that a man such as George Wallace could make it to run for president was something that was hurting us all. It was just like when Duke was on the campaign trail.
David Duke.
It was a terrible feeling. And then when we found out that they were bringing him here to Lynn, you know, we were incensed. And with the help of a lot of people and a lot of young people, I'm talking about high schoolers, they were the ones who were making the signs. They were using their artistic talents. And I mean, some of those signs were beautifully done. The young people put some time into, excuse me, making those signs. And we organized that protest up there at Briarcliff Lodge. And the city officials were so frightened by what might happen that they even figured out how to get George Wallace into Briarcliff without driving him there. They brought him in by water, but that didn't stop us. We were still there in large numbers.
History about Harriet Tubman and George Washington Carver and, you know, all those inventors that we had that were black that we never heard of in school. If they mention it, maybe they mention it once. So I'm glad there's a place like this where you can come here and hear about this. This is a very precious thing to have a place like this, because most cities don't have a place like this, a minority cultural center.
I love the CMCC because it's a neutral base of operation. We're not political, and we're not the NAACP. We're not East Lynn, we're not West Lynn. We insisted on being in the middle of the city, so we would never be East Lynn or West Lynn. And we're not just black. And we took the name minority so that we'd serve all of the races. But our main concerns are with the black and the Hispanic population. No matter what your concerns, you can come there to the cultural center and work them out. Or if it's cultural enrichment, you know, we're there to help you work that out too. So it's joy and it's sadness. If you want to have a get together after a funeral, we'll shine the place up and have the coffee put on and get some food ready. You can come there for that, because that's part of our culture too. If it's forming a church, we'll shine the place up and work with you so that you can do that. So no matter what it is, we try to accommodate the situation there at the cultural center.
Thank you.
Let's see, A's. Got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 A's. B's, 1, 2, 3, 4 B's. Brooke, you got it. Got that trip.
Thank you, thank you.
I have kids come to us and say, Mrs. Spot, you haven't seen me for a long time. That's because I've been away at college. But now I'm back in the community. What can I do? What can I do? Those are the greatest words in the world, the best words in the world. That's the payment. That's the best payment in the world, you know? And I hear those words.
You have to pay your dues. Nothing ever free. You gotta make some sacrifice. And if the person ain't willing to sacrifice in themselves first, if they don't love themselves first, if they don't care about themselves first, they ain't gonna do no organization, regardless whatever it is, any good. I encourage the young people to organize somewhere, whether it's the NAACP or whatever, because if you don't do it collectively, you are not going nowhere individually. But your first, my concern is you gotta love yourself, respect yourself, and never let nobody tear your character down. If you believe in yourself. If you don't believe in yourself, you ain't going nowhere.
I too sing America. I am the by Langston Hughes. I too sing America. I am the darker brother. They send me to eat in the kitchen when company comes. But I laugh, eat well, and grow strong. Tomorrow, when company comes, I'll eat it at the table, and nobody will dare say to me, eat in the kitchen. Besides, they'll see how beautiful I am and be ashamed. I too am America.
People have to remain active, and they have to keep a voice, and they have to stay concerned, because, you know, we're still at war. And I still look at it as war, you know. That war on poverty, that war on concern is still alive, and we have to stay in there. You know, I talk about retiring all the time, but I couldn't sit at home and let things just happen or die away, because there's still so much to be done. You know, we can't sit back and rest while we still have things that need to be done. People have to stay active in order to keep the concern level up and let people know you can fight City Hall, so to speak.